this tag has some fray to it.
The older one is the best one.
That means it survived being on my motorcycle between churches at Chester Hill and Pittsburgh. So that means on a V65, this tire flat in my life, with a purple suit on. And I showed up at church and I said, as I would say, you would think people in Morgan County never saw a man in a purple suit riding a motorcycle on a Sunday morning. There are pictures somewhere. We should be riding a motorcycle.
In a purple suit.
In a purple suit. I used to wear the jacket and pants. I call that suit my 185s. I haven't seen 185 in a while.
You gotta play this game with him.
Yes. I'm not sure he even knows where he's going.
Good morning. Welcome to Hoffman United Methodist Church's broadcast this morning. Glad you're with us. Today we're looking at the 23rd Psalm, which is one of the most beloved of all the Old Testament songs. It was intended to be sung, and it's meant to be a song of hope and promise and joy for our lives. Pray that you are blessed in our time together, and thank you for being with us. Good morning, Hoffman.
Good morning.
Good to see you this beautiful Sunday morning. I was not expecting a beautiful Sunday morning. Forecast sounded like rain all throughout, like all through the night. And I was looking at the raindrops, 7 a.m., 8 a.m., and I'm outside drinking coffee in the sunshine. Like, this is nice. I like it when the weather's wrong in this way. So a beautiful day for the sun to shine. I pray that as we share in our praise and worship together, that the Son of God will shine as well. I know we have a few things coming up on our calendar, so there might be some announcements to be had. I'm holding one of them, aren't I? There are leftover from the library sale. There are some free plants available. You might have seen them on your way in the west doors. Those are available to a home as you go. If you want to take a plant with you, you are welcome to do so. What other updates do we have to share this morning? Chris Long. You have a very small clipboard. Yes. It is a clipboard, but it's a very small one.
But it's a very important one.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, that Pastor Parrish and the board. You all received a notice here of the goodbye, farewell, Evita Zane luncheon we're going to have for Robbie, Bridget, Hannah, and Levi. And it'll be at 12:30 to 2:30 on the 21st. The main thing here today is to pass this around so that if you are willing to have a side dish vegetable, sign up for it, please. And then we are going to be collecting a love offering as well for a special gift in addition to the luncheon. So if you care to do that, just put that in an envelope, mark it Robbie gift, and we'll see to it that that's taken care of. The other thing has nothing to do with that, but I would like to invite any member of the men's group, that's able to help serve this coming Saturday morning for the mother-daughter banquet. I have three people. Actually, I have three and a half. One's about this tall. So we have three and a half men to serve. I would really like to have at least two more, maybe three. It would be there. You'd need to be at the church about 10 o'clock or so, 10:15, and I think you'll be out of there by 12. We'll be serving and probably doing some dishes as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Anyone who wants to wrap vegetables in bacon? Everything's better with bacon. Did I say that with a live mic, didn't I? Any other announcements or updates this morning? Thank you for joining us, those who are online with us. Again, I mentioned at the end of the service last week, I was aware we had a very bad lip sync issue going on. We actually don't know why. We still don't know why. We made little small changes on Monday. I could not make it reproduce what it was doing. So Wednesday, I broadcast from in this room for the readings and prayer and didn't have any problems. So hopefully today everything is going well just with those little changes we made. But make a note in the comments if the sync is really bad. We can't match it exactly. But if it's really bad, let us know and we'll keep trying to solve that mystery. But hopefully it is better today. And for everyone else, lip syncing's not an issue if you're here in person usually. So we'll share in our continued time of worship. Did you have an announcement as well? All right. Well, those who are able, let us stand as we share in our call to worship together.
The Lord is our shepherd.
We are the sheep of Christ's pasture.
The shepherd makes us lie down in green pastures.
In Christ we dwell secure.
The shepherd leads us beside still waters and restores our souls.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, Almighty God, loving Shepherd, we feel the wolves close at hand. Lord, gather us to yourself that we might dwell secure in your ways. Deliver us from evil that we might build a community where all may dwell secure. Mark our fellowship with study, prayer, communion, and the sharing of our possessions with those in need. We pray, Lord, these things in Christ Jesus' name, our Lord and Savior. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Okay, Lydia, what does a helmet cover? Does it cover my foot? No, what does it cover? Our head, good. And inside of our head is our brain, right? So it keeps our brain safe. Soldiers wear helmets too to keep them safe. They have to wear helmets to keep themselves from getting hurt in battle. Now, our next piece of armor that we're going to start talking about is called the helmet of salvation. So God gave us this armor to protect ourselves from various things. So what would the helmet of salvation protect us from? Well, Jesus wants to save us. However, we need to use our brains to decide if that's what we want to do. Do we want Jesus to save us? We all need to decide ourselves to live for God. Now, we can put on the helmet of salvation by deciding to live for God, by becoming his friend, and by being saved. God's salvation protects us from being separated forever from God. It protects us from the attacks of the enemy. Right now, we are in a spiritual battle against Satan, and God has given us this armor to protect us. So we're going to try an experiment, right? We talked about this earlier. So this melon represents us. Oh, thank you. When you do experiments, you have to be protected, right? Okay. So this melon represents us. In John 10:10, it says that Satan comes to destroy us. He will put bad thoughts and temptations in our head, and he will try to get us to do bad things or think bad things about ourselves or bad things about other people. You're really scared, huh? Oh, just in case. Oh, I'm not going to hit you. Remember, it's this. So, let's say that we're all minding our own business, and all of a sudden, here comes the devil to tempt us. This hammer represents Satan coming with a temptation. Yeah! Sorry, I had to make the noise. I just couldn't hit it quietly. Okay. So, that didn't work very well for the melon, did it? When the devil comes with a temptation, it has no protection. We have no protection at all. God has given us this armor, though, to protect us, right? So let's try the next melon with the helmet of salvation. Let's see about that. Now, this melon is prepared, right? Let's see. Yeah! It's all good. This melon is fine. The helmet took the blow and protected the melon from getting hurt. When we wear the helmet of salvation, we are protected from the thoughts and temptations that Satan sends our way. We are saved from hell and can go to heaven if we use our brains to decide to live for God. Does it smell good? It does smell good. Salvation is when Jesus comes into our lives and takes away our sins. He can save us from an eternity in hell. Salvation is the greatest gift that we could ever receive because it took Jesus dying on the cross for us to get to go to heaven. All we have to do is accept that we are sinners, believe Jesus Christ died for our sins, and confess our sins to him. Then we get to spend eternity with God. You want to spell it? Oh, you want to break it. Well, maybe later. All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for this armor that we can use to keep us safe from Satan and his crazy ways. Please guard our hearts, our minds, and our bodies from him each and every day. Lord, we pray for Lydia, and we pray for our whole congregation that we are kept safe this week. Help us to know when Satan is attacking, and help us to turn to you every single time. In your name we pray. Amen.
Morning's anthem is called This World Is Not My Home. As I was checking into this anthem, there are several people that have taken credit for writing this, so I don't know who exactly wrote this anthem, but it's a very good Southern gospel anthem. John Hayes is the one that brought this to my attention. He asked me about this. He only knew the first line of the song, This World Is Not My Home. So I started researching it, and I found it, and found it was sung by several different singers, and then I looked to see if there was a choir arrangement, and there was. And so I ordered it, and so we're going to sing it for you this morning. But this anthem speaks about our hope. If we only looked at what is happening in this world today and what is happening in this country, and this is all that we had to look forward to, it would be very depressing. But we have something else to look forward to. This world is not our home. We are going somewhere special after this world is finished. So, enjoy this anthem.
Thank you.
have our permission to repeat that sometime. Pastor Robbie asked me if I had an announcement, and I said no, but I realized it was just last Sunday that Michael Wayne Smith was here with us, and I praise the Lord that he was here and for Michael and his wife, and that this church was open to his ministry, and the love and support that we shared with Michael Wayne, I deeply appreciate. Thank you so much for supporting his ministry. I was blessed. They were truly blessed, and I pray that those who heard him were blessed. But thank you very much for allowing Michael Wayne to share with us, and thank you for supporting him financially. We should have the offering. So,
yes. I always forget that.
Some of the earliest memories of the church record records of acts of generosity, of meeting the needs of any and all. The church earned the goodwill of everyone who witnessed and experienced this gladness. Let us give with open hearts our ancient brothers and sisters. As our ushers come forward, we are invited to share together God's tithes and our offerings.
Thank you. You may be seated. One additional piece of information concerning last week. It was such a blessing, and I hope those online were still able to receive a blessing from that despite the lip sync issues. And I was concerned enough about it that I downloaded the video and did some video editing to move the video to match with the audio. And so we do have on our Facebook page and on our YouTube page, there is just the concert on there, and it's properly synced up, or at least close enough for horseshoes and hand grenades. I probably should never use that joke in church. I should never say it. It's pretty close to get the lip sync. It's on certain cameras, it's 7 frames off. I know you're just dying to know that. It's 7 frames off, depending on what camera is on. I can't do anything about it. It's just, it's pretty close. So if you want to enjoy that music and ministry, and I know there were some, and you may understand, you may not understand, when you're watching online and the lips get like seconds apart from the video, it's hard to watch or unbearable to watch. So I made the concert so it is watchable in that regard. So anyway, I hope that'll be a blessing for y'all. As we go to the Lord in prayer this day, we know there are folks who are continuing to try to get scheduled in for various procedures or are recovering from surgeries, and we know that our neighborhood and family, I've heard the fire trucks going out multiple times throughout this week, so for all those burdens that we carry into this place of worship, we invite God to be our good shepherd as we cast those cares upon him. Let's be in prayer together. Almighty God, we give you thanks and praise for this day. On a day where we put so much attention on a psalm that is so precious, we know there are a mixture of emotions that come together as we sing the words, as we read the words, as we talk about the words, and we might be taken back to moments of joyful memories, or we might be taken back to times when our hearts were breaking. Lord, we invite you to be at work throughout this service, throughout those memories, throughout even the pain. Or even in those moments of pain, we're reminded that as we go through those valleys of dark shadows that resemble death, you are still present with us. So be present with us today, whether these are joyful times for us to talk about this beloved psalm of David, a shepherd, or whether it's painful for us. We invite you to be present, Lord. Keep us engaged, keep us present in it so that we may see the hope and the promise and the joy of life that is within this psalm. Guide us in your ways. Be with all those who are dear to our hearts and lives. Be with those situations that we feel helpless on the outside looking in. Grant courage and hope and healing to all who are on our hearts. And Father, may you be glorified in all that we share, not only in this service, but as we go from this place. May you be glorified, that our lives may be living sacrifices, living worship services for your sake, for your blessing, for your name to be lifted up. Be present in our praises, we pray. In the name of Christ Jesus, our resurrected Lord, and in whose honor we lift up a model prayer that he first taught his disciples, as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We have two scriptures this morning. One is from Psalm 23, verses 1 through 6. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And from John 10, verses 1 through 10, I tell you the truth, the man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters the gate by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All whoever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. May God add his blessing and give understanding to the reading, hearing, and heeding of his word. Amen.
Thank you, Les. This Sunday on the church calendar is known as Good Shepherd Sunday, and we haven't drawn much attention to it in the past, but typically those two scripture passages will be shared on that Sunday, and today we're going to put the emphasis on the 23rd Psalm. Probably the best known passage in the Bible. People who don't even read the Bible can probably still quote a couple of the verses just because they've heard it in other occasions, many times at funerals. In fact, I was sitting there thinking about how few times I've heard the 23rd Psalm spoken because I'm normally the one reading it. And so it was a blessing to just sit and hear. It's certainly a comforting passage for those who are going through times of mourning. But if we think of it only as a funeral text, we can miss the fact that the psalm is mostly about life and about living. I've said before that we need for the 23rd Psalm to be one that we absorb during times of joy as well as in times of sorrow. But over the last few years, we endured a season where there was a lot of sorrow and a lot of grief, and we heard it over and over in situations that kind of plants it deeper on one side of that continuum. So it takes a while for us to balance those interactions in our head, in our hearts. You know, we have these unintended emotions that are connected to it due to our experiences around it. In part because of that, I think we have to face something difficult about this passage right at the beginning. The Lord is my shepherd. I'm certain through the years you've heard, and I've heard, I've probably said, that there's a challenge with sheep. They're not the smartest animal in the barn. They have a way of wandering off so easily and getting into trouble, and if one sheep wanders, others will follow, and so on and so on. The Lord is my shepherd, this psalm says. David, who would be known as the most powerful king of Israel, a formidable warrior, he's saying he's a sheep. He needs a shepherd. There's a transparency we have to have about ourselves that there are many things that are pulling and pushing at us. Some that inform us, some that drive us. Not all those things are good, though some are. but we can easily wonder. And I have a multitude of emotions that have been pulling at me in recent weeks for obvious reasons. And I've presently entered into that season that happens every year around this time, in which the birthdays, the anniversaries, the death dates, they're all compacted into just a few weeks, reminding us of those who aren't with me on my earthly journey. And I know there are those in the room who have those reminders as well. And I try to be more conscious and mindful of from what place I make decisions and how I react and respond to what's going on around me, because I'm in a little bit more delicate place. We are sheep. We get misled even as we're warning and telling people not to be misled. We can be misled. Someone in the culture of David saying, "The Lord is my shepherd," was similar to saying, "The Lord is my king." You see, in the ancient world, as in ours today, shepherds were herders. They were tenders of sheep. But back then, shepherd was also a metaphor for the role kings were supposed to play. They were to provide and to protect their subjects. But the problem was, many of the kings were lousy shepherds of their people. They were either inept, or they were more concerned with protecting their own, either their own power, their own wealth, or their position on the throne. When someone is saying, "The Lord is my shepherd," saying, "The Lord is my king," the point was that God does what a king shepherd is supposed to do. The person is declaring an intention to live under God's rule. And the rest of the psalm then becomes a description of all the good things that come to that person who's under subject of the Lord as king. I've shared before, but it's been a while, that in college, as I was starting back in, I had an archaeological professor who threw his 2 cents worth into the subject of politics right in the middle of one of his lectures. Now, it wasn't about one party over another or one person over another, so nothing to worry about there. But it was more about the disposition of a president for our country, that in his estimation, this country would never elect an atheist. In his mind, there was no way this country would ever elect an atheist. Now, it wasn't so much a statement of faith, so much was that he believed the people voting wanted to know that the leader of a superpower looked up to somebody. Now, that was 25 years ago. In some ways, the world has changed a great deal, and in some ways, things haven't changed at all from thousands of years ago. There are leaders today on the planet, as long ago, who see themselves and present themselves as gods to their people. But in the church, from a lay person to a pastor to a bishop to a pope, we make the same declaration of faith that was made by a shepherd who became a warrior and then king over 3,000 years ago. "The Lord is my shepherd." Who better than a shepherd to see the parallels between that earthly work and the heavenly work of God? And so in this declaration of faith, there's this listing of qualities for our heavenly shepherd. Now, of course, we shared the King James Version that is the most familiar at the beginning of this text. And there it is possible there are those who hear, "I shall not want," and be like, "Really? I want a lot." And so we always have to take at least a moment and say, well, you know, it's talking about being in want, that the basic needs of the sheep, of us, are cared for. And in fact, you look at what follows, the green pastures, the still waters, providing food, providing clean water to drink. It's about those provisions, not being in want. Makes us lie down in green pastures, leads us beside still waters. The care for the needs of the physical body is one thing, but the Lord being our shepherd also means there's a care for the soul. The Lord restores the soul. If the sheep goes to dangerous places, the one responsible is the shepherd, and it's the shepherd who's at fault. If the Lord is my shepherd, the Lord is going to lead in righteous paths, if for no other reason than because of protecting his great name. Remember, if you will, that was among the arguments Moses made to keep God from smiting the Israelites out in the wandering wilderness. Remember that? Well, remember, you're the one who freed them from the Egyptians. If you take them out in the wilderness and then you smite them all, what's that do to your name? That doesn't look good. The optics aren't very good for that. And because of that, when the journey does go through valleys so dark, they practically reek of death, the one who can be trusted to lead down righteous paths is also the best companion to have when the path is dark. And we may not like this part, but it's good for us to have a reminder, like we do in the 23rd Psalm, that just because the Lord is our shepherd, it doesn't mean we're not going to go through paths that lead through the valley of the shadow of death. But the good shepherd travels the path with us, travels through the valley with us. And then there is also the question of whether the valley should be avoided. You likely know that one of our country's national parks is actually called Death Valley. It's the lowest, the driest, the hottest space in our country. It once recorded a high temperature of 134 degrees Fahrenheit. It was a dry heat. In fact, temperatures approaching 120 are not uncommon during the summers there. And the summers start early. Their own literature warns that May starts the summer season, and that's when campers usually choose not to spend overnight in tents in Death Valley. And so here we are waiting for spring to actually settle in, and their summer is already starting. The park stays relatively busy during the summer despite there not being many campers. You know why? Car companies are continually bringing existing models of vehicles as well as prototypes of future vehicles to Death Valley because they need those cars to experience the worst possible heat conditions. They need them to experience that so that when consumers buy their vehicles, they can have relative trust that when they're stuck in rush hour on a summer day in July in Ohio, that the car will still perform as it should, and the persons riding inside manage to be comfortable. The final product of vehicle is a better product if the design has been properly tested. And whether we like it or not, the heat of the valley of the shadow of death puts us through the test. Maybe we come out of it realizing we're stronger than we ever thought we were, or maybe we have a radiator hose that blows and we feel like we've taken two steps backward. But we weren't alone in that valley, and we wouldn't be here for this conversation today without those extreme moments in our lives. By and large, the final product of a living faith is better and stronger having been tested through the valley of the shadow of death. And yes, some of those valleys have left scars on us, on the outside and on the inside. But our resurrected Lord, thanks be to God, he also bore scars. The good shepherd himself had scars. As far as the physical valleys in the Judean wilderness, for a physical of what David was writing about, apparently there were multiple areas where there were cracks and crevices that were small and numerous, just large enough for a sheep to fall into. And it was like a maze from which there was no outlet. And in the errant wanderings, the sheep could end up wandering into some crag and getting caught or trapped or be attacked by a predator. But if the shepherd was with that sheep, then the tools of the shepherd could, just like the arms of a parent or grandparent or a sibling can guide a young one away from the dangerous spots, correct the errant wanderings. I've read that the hook of the shepherd's crook could reach down into those various crevices and lift the sheep out of danger. The rod and the staff remind of the protection from predators. When David spoke of his lack of fear of Goliath, he recalled that when a lion and a bear attacked his flock of sheep, he killed them because he was a shepherd. The good shepherd is the kind of one who fights the battles for us. The shepherd is responsible for protecting the sheep. And so that rod and staff is not just for guiding and correcting, but also for protecting against predators. Now, I got to admit that the table prepared, that always had a very human feel to it. That doesn't have an obvious sheep connection to it. But in the research, I learned that when there's a safe place for the sheep to rest and feed, it was sometimes called the table. And it was often in a protected or even fenced area where predators could see the sheep, but they couldn't get to them. The Lord prepares a table, even in the presence of enemies. I've always felt the anointing of the head with oil was a little out of sorts, and I would normally, in my mind, put it in the same category as the cup running over and surely goodness. I thought of it as a special blessing that God selected those as kings were anointed, so I was connecting to those passages in Scripture, that the word Messiah in Christ literally means anointed one. But it turns out there is an additional lesson from shepherds about the anointing with oil and sheep. Sheep will often get their head caught in briars, and they'll die trying to get untangled. And in addition, there are horrible little flies, terrible little flies, that torment sheep by laying eggs within their nostrils. Those eggs turn into worms that crawl up into their head and their brain. I just want to see if anyone pulled out a kerchief or tissue. I just thought it might be a little overwhelming for somebody, a little nose twitch. It'll drive the sheep mad. And they'll even beat their head against a rock trying to get it all to stop. And so, the shepherd anoints their whole head with oil. The oil forms a barrier of protection against the evil that tries to destroy the sheep. And the sheep is given a sense of peace. There was actually a member of the church who shared a posting about this practice earlier this week. As I said, this Sunday is called Good Shepherd Sunday. And so it's not surprising some of these memes surface to the top and come into our feeds this time of year. I don't even have to ask if there's any among us who suffer from mental torment, whether it's worrisome thoughts that invade our minds over and over and over again, or whether it's other things that come in and words of others or actions of others disturb us in ways and deeper than we feel they ever should. I wonder, though, if when we feel we're trying to stop them, if we feel like we're beating our head against the wall. Psalm 23 reminds us that we can ask for God's anointing in the midst of those times. I've went through years where I heard this asking for God's anointing more from a Pentecostal charismatic framework, but that isn't the only type of anointing that's available. And not only that, when it comes to God's anointing, there's an endless supply. An endless supply. We don't have to ask once and stop asking. If we're in that time of need and we're in that time we feel like we're being driven nuts by the little pesky thoughts, pesky attitudes, you know, we can ask for God's anointing to protect us. I'm not going to say much about this next part, but, you know, visual aids we're in today. We got that unspoken thing. And I thought maybe I could take a pitcher and I could take a cup. But you know, it's a visual. I will grant that. Sometimes we need to place the visual in a different context and it changes the meaning for us. So I'm going to change the context. Our cup runneth over. Remember your baptism and be thankful. That's a mess. The 23rd Psalm is a psalm of trust. It's a psalm of confidence. It was written by one who knew what it was to walk through the dark valley and come out the other side. Here's a challenging thing when it comes to faith. It is faith. There's not proof. If there's proof, it's no longer going to be faith. Two persons can come to the same evidence and come to different conclusions. I always appreciate that about the Creation Museum. That's one of the first exhibits they have, that two persons with two different frameworks, two different backgrounds come to the same evidence and they're going to draw two different conclusions. And I think that's extremely fair. And so for one person, the fact that there is a valley of the shadow of death they travel through, for them is proof that God doesn't exist, that a good God wouldn't allow these things to happen to us. And for others, going through that valley was proof that God was there all along, walking with us and talking with us, reminding us that we are his own. Same evidence, different conclusions. The 23rd Psalm is a psalm of hope, and it's about our living more than it is about our dying. Is the Lord our shepherd? I thought I would share a different reading from it. I've shared with a few here a favorite translation to read whenever I want to get a poetic sense of Scripture is one called the New Jerusalem Bible. And the 23rd Psalm is worded different enough that it shakes us up a little bit and we get to hear it with fresh ears. So I'd like to share in closing the New Jerusalem Bible version. And then we're going to sing yet another version, right, Norman?
Yes.
Yahweh is my shepherd. I lack nothing. In grassy meadows he lets me lie. By tranquil streams he leads me to restore my spirit. He guides me in paths of saving justice as befits his name. Even were I to walk in a ravine as dark as death, I should fear no danger, for you are at my side. Your staff and your crook are there to soothe me. You prepare for me under the eyes of my enemies. You prepare a table for me under the eyes of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup brims over. Kindness and faithful love pursue me every day of my life. I make my home in a house of Yahweh for all time to come. That's the New Jerusalem Bible translation of the 23rd Psalm. I'd like to invite us to be in a moment of prayer together. Holy God, we thank you. This is but one chapter of one book of your word, and it carries so much. In Christ's name, may we be encouraged by you as our good shepherd. May we be reminded of what that entails. May we see your goodness in all our circumstances. May we be aware, even looking back on the darkest times in our lives, how you were present with us, and that you are present with us even now. Lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. We ask that our hearts be humble before you and that we allow ourselves to be led by you in all circumstances, in our homes, in our workplaces, in our church. Be our good shepherd, Lord, we ask in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. If those who can stand will stand as we sing.
Thank you.
in seminary, I had a outline I made in preaching class of a six-week sermon series on the 23rd Psalm, called it Calling All Sheep, and it was just an outline, and it did tempt me, because I never have actually done that sermon series, but I thought, well, that would be like all the weeks, so we condensed it into one, but rest assured, there's a lot in the 23rd Psalm, and that means there's a lot in all the Word for us to glean and to grow from. May it be as we go from this place, we live as those who call the Lord our great shepherd. May we be the sheep of his pasture, people of his flock, reaching out to other sheep who need to know the good shepherd too. May this be so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. Go in peace, friends.